Conversation with the Candidate continues.
Welcome back to Conversation with the Candidate and our candidate tonight, Senator Michael Bennet of Colorado. We're going to bring in our audience of New Hampshire voters here for their town hall questions, and we're going to start tonight with Nancy Keene.
Hi. Hi. Thank you for coming to this wonderful opportunity for us as a studio audience to get to talk to you one-on-one. This is a wonderful opportunity. Now, that being said, our nation is really, really divided right now, and it's hard to have a civil conversation with someone on the opposite side or who has different beliefs than you do. We're not really talking very well to each other. So I'm wondering if you could think of anything that you could do to bring our nation, our civility back.
So I thank you very much for the question, and I love your shoes, by the way. We have them throughout everybody in our household. I think it's such an incredibly important question. The founders of this country did not make an assumption that we would agree with each other. When they put this whole thing together, when they created what they called a republic, what we call a democracy, their expectation was that we would have disagreements. That was the point of being in a free society. But they thought out of those disagreements, we would fashion more imaginative and more durable solutions than any king could have come up with on our own. We've totally lost that in our national politics, completely. I've spent the last 10 years of my life representing a state that's a third Democratic, a third Independent, and a third Republican. And when I was one of the votes for the Affordable Care Act in 2010, I didn't just go to liberal places in my state. I spent a lot of time on the eastern plains of Colorado in counties where I'll never win more than 30% of the vote, no matter what I do, making sure people there understood why I was trying to do what I was doing. And that was the whole year, you might remember, of the Tea Party and all people yelling in all these town halls and all that. And not a single town hall in Colorado was like that. I've never had an interaction like that in my state in 10 years. And I think our elected leaders in Washington need to meet a level of expectation that says you got to find a way through your disagreements. Not every disagreement we have is a matter of principle, but even when we have a matter of principle, the most important thing we have to do is figure out how to move the country forward, how to make progress for the next generation of Americans. We cannot do that in these warring camps. The last point I think I'll make is this. I actually don't think the country is anywhere as divided as our media makes it seem like it is, or the social media makes it seem like it is. I mean, people who spend all their time watching cable TV at night and are engaging on social media with their politicians are extremely well represented in Washington, D.C. We genuflect to people that are doing that. But that's only about 12 million people in America. The rest of America is 220 million people who are getting up in the morning wanting to raise their family, wanting to build a small business, wanting to figure out how to pay for college or childcare for their kids. And that's who I want to work for as President of the United States, because they have a bunch of issues that we need to resolve, and they're not getting resolved because of the kind of insanity that you're talking about. So thanks for starting on that point.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Nancy. Next question comes from Kathleen Hoey.
Hi, Senator. Welcome to New Hampshire.
Thank you.
So my question is, what do you think about the trade war with China and the other trade agreements with some of the other countries like Mexico and Canada? Do you think that they're going to benefit Americans? And also, would you reconsider the Trans-Pacific Partnership?
All great questions. I think the trade war is a really bad idea. I think that China had been doing China's trade policies had been unfair to the United States, and Donald Trump was right to call that out. I think the way he did it, which has provoked a trade war because of the tariffs he put on, is nothing more than a tax on our farmers when they've already got low commodity prices as it is, a tax on our workers, and a tax on our consumers. And he keeps denying that's true. He keeps saying China is paying for all of this. They're not paying for it any more than Mexico is paying for the wall that he said that they would pay for. So I think that's bad, and what I would like us to do is understand that we have a commonality of interest with countries all over the world, with the possible exception of North Korea, Russia, and China, in the sense that none of us wants to be run by China, and none of us is big enough to compete with China on our own. That creates a huge opportunity for us to work with our allies in this region, but also in Europe and in places around Asia, because they also don't want to be dominated by China to say, look, these are what the rules of the road are going to look like. Stealing our intellectual property is not fair. Having state-sponsored businesses that compete unfairly with our businesses is not fair. Not opening your markets to us when we are opening your markets to you is not fair. And I think there's real strength in numbers, you know, if we work together with our allies. President Trump has jettisoned ally after ally after ally in his effort to sort of just, I think, stay on the cable news at night. We've got to do a lot better than that. I think on TPP, the countries that were involved in that went ahead and signed the agreement themselves. And that means that there are markets that need to be open to our agriculture that are not now open to agriculture. So as we think about maybe reopening TPP, we need to make sure that it's got the labor and environmental protections that we would want. But we can't just turn our back on these global markets. That's where most of the growth is going to come for agriculture and for actually manufacturing exports right here in New Hampshire.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Kathleen. Yeah. Quick follow on that.
And by the way, go ahead.
No,
you go ahead.
Well, do you think NAFTA has been a net benefit for American workers?
I think it's been a benefit for some agricultural workers, for example, and it's been a real detriment to others, auto workers, for example. And we need to be aware and honest with the American people about where it's worked and where it hasn't worked.
Social media question coming in from Carolyn Hannon. What is your greatest hope for our nation?
My greatest hope for our nation is that we will have an economy that when the economy grows, everybody benefits from that, which we have not had for the last 40 years, that we will have a restoration of our political institutions and our political vocabulary and our politics, so we're actually supporting the next generation of Americans. So we can fulfill the example that our parents and grandparents set for us. That's an important example that they set. It's not that they did everything perfectly, but they at least tried. And I think the best way we can fulfill that legacy is by making sure that we pass it on to the next generation of Americans and give them a chance to fulfill that legacy as well. That's what I hope for our country.
Next question comes from Terrence Ganarian.
Thank you for being here, Senator.
Thank you, Terrence.
As a legal immigrant who is now proudly a U.S. citizen, coming to the United States and being part of American Dream, I understand the issues of illegal immigration and those that are who lack the proper respect of coming to the United States legally. With that being said, I know many of those individuals still aspire to be part of the American dream. If elected president, how do you plan to support that population and what is your plan for immigration?
Do you mind if I ask where you're from?
I was born in Guyana.
Thank you for the question. Like you, my family has an immigrant story on one side of the family. My mom and her grandparents were Polish Jews who miraculously survived the Holocaust. And they stayed in Poland because my grandfather couldn't imagine leaving his family behind. And everybody was killed in their family except the three of them and an aunt. And after the war was over, they lived in Poland for 2 years. Then they went to Stockholm, Sweden for a year. Then they went, of all places, to Mexico City for a year. And then they came to the United States of America to rebuild their shattered lives, where they became, you know, among the most patriotic Americans I've ever known. They had very thick accents, my grandparents, far thicker than any accent that anybody has in my state. And we've got a lot of immigrants in my state. What I would do is work to pass comprehensive immigration reform. I was part of the Gang of Eight in 2013, four Democrats and four Republicans who negotiated the immigration bill in the Senate. We got 68 votes for that bill. That bill, by the way, had more border security in it than what Donald Trump's talking about. It had $46 billion in border security. Donald Trump says Democrats are for open borders. That's a lie. You're for a secure border. I'm for a secure border. You're for the rule of law and immigration. I'm for the rule of law and immigration. But we weren't building a medieval wall down there. We were actually using technology and other kinds of barriers to create a safe border. We created internal security as part of that bill so that this whole issue of, you know, the fact that 40% of the people here that are undocumented came lawfully but overstayed their visa, America has no way to deal with that right now. We fixed that problem. We fixed the problem of small businesses having to be the immigration police by updating what's called E-Verify so they could tell who was lawful and not lawful. And we created a pathway to citizenship for the 11 million people that are here that nobody's going to deport back to where they came from. But it was a tough but fair path. And finally, we had the most progressive Dream Act that had actually ever even been written that was passed as part of that bill. And you say, so you might ask, what happened? And what happened was the tyranny of the minority in the House of Representatives, where the Freedom Caucus got to run roughshod over a bill that is still, if you poll people in America and ask them, what should we do about immigration, it's the elements of the Gang of Eight bill. So that's what I would want to do as president, and I'd want to do it quickly after assuming the office.
Thank you.
Thank you for the question.
Senator, on the issue of a wall, a physical barrier does have a role, though, in some parts of the border.
Of course. But look, Donald Trump goes down there, Adam, and he has a photo op, and he stands. I don't know if I'm allowed to walk over here. Is that all right? He stands, and he'll have three of what, like this, his three steel slats. That's what he calls them. We had 350 miles of steel slats in the Gang of Eight bill. 350 miles. So he's sort of foisted on the American people this idea that there are people in America that don't seriously want border security, or that the Democratic Party, as I said earlier, is for open borders. I wrote a bill with much more border security in it than Donald Trump is talking about with his wall. It's just that it was effective and smart. And it came with other parts of dealing with that. One thing I didn't mention earlier was we worked hard. I negotiated with Marco Rubio and Dianne Feinstein and Orrin Hatch to create what was called the Ag Jobs Provision. A lot of you may know that we're depending on foreign-born workers for our agriculture in many places. That was the first time ever that we'd had a bill that was endorsed by both the Farm Workers Union and the growers all across America. So that's the kind of progress we actually made. And again, we got stopped by a group of people coloring far outside the mainstream of what's conventional American political thought. Not just Democratic thought, not just independent thought, but in my state, even Republican thought. To go back to your first question, when I started working on immigration, I went out in Colorado and I created something called the Colorado Compact to bring people together on a set of principles. And when we announced it, it was surprising and shocking to a lot of people, but we had some of the most conservative groups in Colorado who represent farmers and ranchers and who know they're not going to preserve their family farms and ranches with this kind of immigration policy. And on the other hand, some of the most progressive immigration rights people in the state. So I think it is possible to bring people together if you'll actually make an effort to do it. And going on the cable at night is not the same thing as sitting with people in their living rooms or in their communities, asking them to tell you what their concerns or hopes are for our immigration process. I still am absolutely convinced that something along the lines that does include some border security could pass the House and Senate and go to the president for a signature, or me for my signature if I were president.
Next question comes from Ken Berlin.
Hi, Senator Bennet. Welcome, and I'm glad your health is better.
Oh, thank you.
You touched on part of what my question is to you regarding the shutdown. After seeing the last debacle that we just had for 35 days and watching everything about how the millions of Americans that work for the government couldn't go to work, we lost a lot of money. Even when they came back to work, they had to catch up with everything. It affected air traffic controllers, TSA. It happens too often. So my question to you is, what could you do as president to ensure that even if you can't come to an agreement on the budget, you could keep the government open because the funding is still there? These people are still getting the money that they were going to
get. It makes no sense from a fiscal point of view at all, as you're saying. And it drives me crazy because it's not like the rest of the world isn't moving on. You know, it's not as though China isn't continuing to build 3,000 miles of fiber optic cable between Africa and Latin America when we are shut down, or landing a spaceship on the dark side of the moon, or building its one job or one road, one belt, one road initiative. That's all going on while we're doing this. And the Iranians are all doing what they're doing. And by the way, it wasn't just the shutdown. It was 6 months of having the American people consumed by the president and his $6 billion medieval wall, or the wall that Mexico is supposed to pay for. One other thing I probably should mention is that the $46 billion in border security in our original proposal was actually paid for by immigration fees, not by the Mexicans and not by taxpayers. So that's another thing we could do together. I think this starts by having politicians in Washington who don't believe it is beneficial to shut the government down. We should not shut the government down over politics. No school district, I used to be a school superintendent, no mayor would ever get away with saying, oh, we couldn't come to an agreement on $20,000, which is about the amount of money we're talking about here in the scheme of things. And that's why we shut the government down and aren't plowing the snow or not letting your kids go to school. I think the proposal that I've had on this has been that I think that the United States Senate should have to appear at 8 o'clock the next morning after there's a shutdown, whether the House created it or the Senate created it or a president created it. We should be there at 8 o'clock the next morning, and we should not be able to leave until the government's reopened, because the politicians never pay a price on this. And we continue to get paid. When I tell people at home this story, or about this bill that I've had for several years, the part they like the best is that if senators don't show up, the sergeant at arms can go out and arrest them and drag them to the floor. But that's not the only thing. I think there are other changes we could make that would also get people to actually start focusing on the American people's business instead of something else. I think we should ban members of Congress from ever becoming lobbyists, for example. If you've had the privilege to serve in the House or the Senate, you shouldn't become a lobbyist in Washington, D.C. after. But half the people that leave Congress and don't retire become lobbyists. Sometimes people ask me, well, how are we finally going to get health care solved? I think one way to solve that would be by taking away the subsidy that lawmakers get when we live in a country where we haven't had the dignity to actually give universal health care to everybody in this country. It'd be amazing how quickly people would start to want to function if they realized that they would lose something. It shouldn't have to come to that, but it has come to that in our modern politics.
Thanks,
Ken. Thank you.
And we've got about a minute left. I want to do a quick follow on the government shutdown question. In our audience today, we have Romeo and Catherine Dupuy. Their son Trevor serves in the Coast Guard. He was one of about 43,000 service members that didn't get paid from that December to January period. Is there any protection you can offer to members of our armed forces, the Coast Guard, in the event of another government shutdown?
I, first of all, thank you for your son's service in the Coast Guard. We're all very grateful for that. I think it was an abomination that they weren't paid in the Coast Guard. It is an abomination that the federal workers weren't paid either. I think we shouldn't divide people from each other. I think what we should say is anybody who is willing to serve the United States of America well should be honored by being paid and should not be dishonored by political fights they have nothing to do with. So I think your son should be paid, and I think the federal workforce should be paid. If anybody should not be paid, it's members of Congress that shut the government down.
Senator Bennett, that'll do it for the television portion of Conversation with the Candidate. Thank you for joining
us. Adam.
Next week, we're going to have Washington Governor Jay Inslee on the program. Until then, we thank you for joining us. Thank you for our town hall audience. And again, thank you to you, Senator Bennett, for joining us on Conversation with the Candidate. Have a good evening.
Thank you.